Even mute I haven't done.
Okay, thanks a lot for coming. So today's session is on OpenStack Keystone Deep Dive. So I will be covering introduction to INT services, a service in OpenStack, the Keystone concept, configuration we use, demo one, integration with IPA LDAP backend, and demo two. Hopefully we should be able to complete all, but if not, we can make arrangements for that. We have already shared an etherpad for DevStack. At the end, I have also mentioned 2-3 steps to get Docker image and start a Docker image for free IPA. That is IPA, which will act as the LDAP server for us. So introduction to identity service. So what is Keystone? So is there anyone who has not worked on OpenStack? Mm-hmm. Okay. So basically this is what OpenStack looks like.
So it is very light over here. Let me find something.
It is visible on there.
Yeah. Okay. So this is how your OpenStack environment looks like. So your OpenStack is an open source solution. It's an open source project. It is made up of multiple components. Something unique about OpenStack, what is you will notice is it's made up of multiple open source projects, and each open source project gives some kind of functionality, and these functionalities give some behavior which is delegated. For example, OpenStack is an infrastructure as a service. Infrastructure means networking, storage, file system. You have NetApp server or something like that. So all these parts, you have some components which handles this functionality and provides it as a service in an OpenStack environment. For example, you have OpenStack networking service. Okay, this component represents Neutron project. The Neutron, the first one which you see after INT service, OpenStack networking service, represents Neutron. Okay, so Neutron makes sure in your OpenStack environment all the networking, your virtual routers, what you create, networks that you create, is emulated and handled by OpenStack networking service. Similarly, for each service, there's a component, there's a project which actually is growing very successfully, and there are a lot of companies who work in these specific domains like EMC, NetApp, and storage. So they are writing their own modules to integrate with their product with OpenStack block storage service. So these all are the service generic names. These components have specific names. For example, networking is Neutron, storage is Cinder, compute service is Nova. By the way, last month we had a session on Nova. Then you have image services, Glance, objects, storage services, Swift, telemetry, Cenometer, Noki, AODH, orchestration is done by Heat. So each of this is actually a project. And each of this project provides some kind of cloud functionality. And what we are going to talk about today is identity service. So this is what I was saying. What is unique about OpenStack is it's very modular. Not only that the projects are divided with some functionality, the projects itself is very modular, which gives advantage for a developer to write a plugin to integrate their product. For example, if EMC started providing a new product, storage product, it will write a new plugin and it will put in the upstream Cinder so that the customers and other vendors who provide OpenStack like Red Hat or HP or Veritas who provide OpenStack can pull in the same code base and give it to customers. So customers who buy EMC or NetApp storage, they can use that driver along with it. So this is how it usually works in enterprise, how vendors write in their plugins and get things done. So our main motto is to understand how identity works. So some of you have worked on OpenStack. If you have not, worked on. The INT service is a component that provides authentication and authorization in your OpenStack environment. So you won't hear too much of it because a lot of people are not involved in integrating KeyStone, but KeyStone, or that is the INT service. But people who do for an enterprise will understand that it's the importance of security. So you cannot provide a product without security. That's that will nullify the use case in an enterprise environment. You don't want everything to be open, right? So that's what KeyStone comes into picture. So don't just look at KeyStone as authentication and authorization. It's a solution for cloud. So whatever the market requires, it needs to fulfill. So considering that idea, when we move, we come across with a lot of suggestions from vendors, like from security organizations, like they want some kind of security, they want some kind of protocols. If you have interacted with your security team or someone who handles with authentication and all, you understand that authentication requirements go very complex for certain environments. Maybe you have a company which have internal users, internal employees. You have customers also logging to same maybe cloud. So your customers will be using some different authentication mechanism, but you have same cloud product or cloud environment or infrastructure. So you want your customers, your employees also to log in, your customers also to log in. So your authentication service needs to communicate with both your internal enterprise authentication server and your customer's authentication server. It's not necessarily it's an LDAP server or it's Active Directory.
It gives you a header, or it's just like a LDAP gives you identity. That's what.
So this is the project in OpenStack that handles authentication on a general for everything.
So this is similar kind of AWS IAM services.
I am not sure of AWS IAM service, but it is
equal to
IAM.
Okay, so it is. So its goal is whatever authentication you have, it should integrate that. So so there are quite a bit of authentication solutions. I mean, what you can integrate this with, you can you have LDAP, Active Directory. You have we have a solution called KeyCloak. If you may have heard of, it's OpenIDC and Federation for Federation. We use OpenIDC and so we have a product called RHSSO, or upstream is called KeyCloak, which also can be used for as a backend. So this is our what we are going to talk about today, KeyStone. What are let's talk about KeyStone INT service. So let me talk first about some of the jargons we use, words we use when we refer to KeyStone. An actor, normally no one says actor because it sounds like some film star, but it's either a user or a group. But if you are actually looking inside the KeyStone code, you will notice something like actor ID or something. A user or a group. Okay, so user has a credential. Okay, group will have a set of users. Users while giving the credential to KeyStone, it gets a token. The token is some information provided by KeyStone showing who you are, and you can use this token to talk to other components in OpenStack to identify yourself. So this token is can be used for authentication or authorization. There are different there are different types of tokens also. Before that, we'll leave it that for now. Then you have roles. Roles are some certain names that you provide, some abstraction, which gives you some level of privilege. Yes, authorization. So that's authorization. That's roles. So roles are unique within a domain. So you can have multiple domains in OpenStack. So KeyStone can have multiple domains. Domain is a higher level of abstraction. So roles are unique within a domain. So if you have multiple domains, you can have multiple roles with same name in different domains. So whenever you mention a role, you have to mention domain. So domain terminology started from KeyStone version 3. Version 2, KeyStone did not have this domain logic. So once KeyStone version 3 came up, your KeyStone version 3 API supports clients providing queries to KeyStone server saying that I am from this domain and this is role to identify itself. So project is synonymous to tenant, what we used to use earlier. We start using the term project to identify a set of resources. Usually this project is created and given to a team or a user, and there are a set of resources created inside this project, like images, volumes, networks, routers, etc. That's a project. Project is also unique within a domain, not across all domains. So domains, as I mentioned, it's an abstraction, higher level abstraction of the resources in OpenStack. So domain also you can use to have backend to certain INT services like LDAP or Active Directory. So if you want users of a certain domain to be authenticated from a certain identity server, LDAP or Active Directory or Keycloak or some federation, you can do configuration on that. We will come to that later. That's one of the points we are going to discuss in this session. Then service. So in OpenStack, you have so many services. Okay, so these are not all the services. There are lot more services. So I got this picture from our Red Hat documentation, and we don't support all the projects inside OpenStack, because many projects come up and they don't mature very fast. So until the project is not mature for an enterprise solution, we don't. But my point is, there is a lot of projects in OpenStack, a lot of projects in OpenStack, which is not listed over here. Each project gives some or the other functionality. Just like a quick review, I can make out, we don't have Manila. By the way, Manila we support. Manila is file system as a service. So you have Sahara, which I just mentioned. Sahara is big data as a service. So there are a lot of services which we have not included.
So this file, which is the service that you can, as a file, you store as an object itself, or it's a blob storage?
Yes, so you have alternative to select that.
So just a FileNet kind of thing, which is IBM has a...
So the thing is, I just mentioned a project name called Manila. Mm-hmm. So it provides file system as a service. So your backend can be anything for which it has driver, plugin for. And the plugin is provided by the vendor. So IBM has a storage server, and they have provided a plugin to upstream OpenStack for Manila to use it, then you can use it.
They only have it with Cinder.
IBM. I'm just
Manila example. Is just
Manila, you have Ceph.
We have introduced this only in one of our Ceph trainings, yeah. Ceph 1-5. Yeah. And Manila is Red Hat is supporting Ceph integration behind the scenes. That's all.
Okay, so I'm again deviating from the topic. So mm-hmm. Our main topic is KeyStone. Yeah. So the thing is, so many services information, KeyStone is aware. So it keeps a database entry of all the services that are available. So it has a service name, which is a very specific name for each of this. So for Cinder, it'll have Cinder and Cinder V2 or V3, something like that name. So for each service, it has information stored in KeyStone. So whenever a service or a user want to access a service, it does not need to know the IP address of the host on which it's running. For example, if in case my storage block service wants to communicate with compute service or compute the other way, if the compute wants to communicate to storage block, it does not have the IP address. So whichever server this Noah computer is running, and the configuration has no information of block storage service, that which host it's running, which IP address it is, which port it's not aware. What if each of the services aware is where KeyStone is running. So each service or a user's client has the IP address of KeyStone. It reaches out to KeyStone, and obviously there is authentication, authorization thing also involved. when it reaches out to Keystone, and Keystone tells it, okay, this is the guy who has Cinder on business port. So that is how services and users communicate with each other. So this this service is also provided by Keystone by maintaining a database for services and also having some endpoints for these services. So there is one information for services, all the services that are there in your environment. And then for each of the service, what is the endpoint? Endpoint means there's an HTTP URL, HTTP or HTTPS colon, a host name or IP address colon, the port number slash maybe some URL which is required for API. So this much information is there in endpoint. So this much information is required for other users to access each of these services. Now endpoints also, there are three types of endpoints. One is admin URL, internal URL, and public URL. When a user usually uses logs in and tries to use your consumes your OpenStack, he runs on Horizon, clicks something, he uses public URL. So every request in your OpenStack cannot be passed via public URL. There are some certain admin tasks that only admin URL you have to access. It depends upon what your admin URL is configured as, but that is the advantage of admin URL. Internal URLs are used internally for communicating. So this endpoint thing is not just for Keystone. I'm saying the endpoint is saved inside Keystone database, but for each service, there's an endpoint. It's stored in Keystone. And there are three types of endpoints for each service. This is a good example. I did OpenStack catalog list, and this is the first output. I don't want to cover my whole screen with all the service outputs. For Noah, type service name Noah, it's type compute, and endpoints, the three endpoints, public URL, internal URL, and admin URL. So it's a good example over here that after the port number, you have slash V2. So you are actually different projects, your components. Cinder, Noah, Glance may have different versions, and maybe the API requires you to put slash the version name also. So that, as for that, you have to put your create your service endpoint. So back to our concepts. You would have noticed there is something called as region one. So when you save this endpoint details, it says service, region, and the URL. Is an admin URL or internal URL? The URL. So the region is actually another one abstraction used for a set of OpenStack services. All these services is in one region, and these services communicate to its own region. Okay. Now you can configure another one region for your own purpose. Mostly we use multiple regions to identify different geographical locations. So if I had multiple geographical locations, I want same kind of cloud, but I can probably not merge it together because one is in maybe Pune, others in Chennai, and the latency is bad. I cannot create I cannot create a virtual router on one of the controllers in Pune and expect the instance using the virtual router in Chennai to have a fast access. I probably want leave about that in depth. Okay, even if my instance is running, VM is running on a compute on say Chennai data center, and if my controllers are one of the controller which it wants to talk is in Pune, maybe Cinder or whatever. So that much latency you're adding. So what you would want is you want to segregate the services. Okay, Pune guys has a different set of you have different service for same services, and Chennai you also have different services. So you will deploy two environments with services on different nodes, and you will make sure that this is identified by the region number, region value. Okay. So when the services communicate with each other on Chennai region, it knows that I need to communicate with Chennai region. So another one additional note on that on that same line is that it is always recommended that when you have multiple regions, both regions keystored should have all the and catalog. Means the catalog should reflect both regions. It should not be that one keystone only reflects one certain, only that region's catalog, but your whole cloud's catalog.
There will be two keystone or one keystone?
You will have two keystones.
So then there will be two clouds.
Yeah, so you will have to make sure that the keystone configuration is configured in such a way that it will give you full catalog with both the regions. So that's how you have developers suggest, because there are some functionalities and features of having this available or visible on the same keystone. So that was the region concept. I have a so an example. This is an example of a region, two regions, region one and region two. You have all services except for dashboard. You notice I not draw a dashboard up for region one because you have a common dashboard. Oh, by the way, you can install how many dashboards you want, but this is a more generic layout where customers deploy in such a way. They have one horizon and the horizon is configured to communicate with use both keystone, and your keystone will also have some backend federation. So I will not talk about federation in detail because that is I would not plan to cover that. But that is how the region thing works. So you can have multiple regions.
Can we integrate one region's keystone with, let's say, LDAP and other ones with IPA?
Yes.
And with one dashboard, does that the location where domain comes in? That you have to decide that which keystone do I have to choose or which domain do I have to choose? Because one
is LDAP. So every keystone can have n number of domains. Okay, that domains you can have one INT backend. You can have same configure on that keystone also. So the federation makes sure that whatever you authenticate and get the token is shared between both keystone, if at all it's required. When it's required, it will share that information to make sure your token is valid.
What I'm saying is there is on the LDAP backend and IT backend, which is integrated both at one inch.
Yeah, that's what I said. You can make sure that the federation does it, but I'm not sure if IP and LDAP has that that behavior or not. But when you use federation with key cloak and all, it works that way.
Okay, automatically.
Yes. So I have not researched much on the federation part, so if you ask me too much questions, also I will not be able to answer. Okay, the next is catalog. So catalog is just the combination of service information and the endpoint. So that is, you probably guess that by the output command name. So you saw OpenStack catalog list and you got this. So let's catalog. Roles assignments are same. I should have removed that. Let's come to policy. Okay, so policy, you can set some kind of policies for each API. So each, for example, keystone provides some API queries. Like, I could do OpenStack catalog list, I could do OpenStack service list. So see, these are all APIs I can give to keystone, and this policies can help you write some rules to allow or deny any user based on maybe a role or group or many things. I will show that also to you. So that is what a policy is. The region which I just spoke of earlier. So if you have any queries on things that I asked, you can immediately ask me and clear them.
Is availability zone and host aggregate different thing? It's a part of a region.
So availability zone.
It's a different altogether, different
process. So actually, availability zones are created in NOAA, and that information is saved in NOAA. Okay, so this is an example of authentication authorization. So user gives his user credentials, username, password, and this goes to first the Keystone. So if in case I run a, say, OpenStack service list, is actually a query to find out all the VMs running on my environment for my credential or for my login, whichever permission I have access, all those VMs I can list in OpenStack server list. Okay, but the command will first reach out to Keystone, because the client does not, that OpenStack service list client does not know the NOAA's API's endpoint or the IP address from which it has. It will first go to the Keystone service, get authenticate itself. Okay, so this is an example of that. So a user first authenticates by giving the credential, username, password to the Keystone service. Keystone service will have an INT backend. It will check the identity backend for that user, confirm this is. So INT servers can be SQL based, that is in your database itself, or you can have it via LDAP. There are other options also to use external authentication like KeyCloak. So once it's authenticated, it gets an unscoped token. So it's a general token the user gets. So this token is not specific to any project. The token does not have information of how much privilege that person has for the tenant which he's trying to access. So in your client also, there's an option for tenant or the project you're going to access. It gets the token, sends another request to get the tenants. Okay. And once the tenant's information is again sent with the token, it gives a service catalog back. So the service catalog, at this point, when it sends this token with the tenant, the Keystone will check if this person has permission to do that operation. Like in this case, it gets service catalog, means service list permission it should have. If it does not have service list permission, this would probably fail. But if he has permission, it will give back the token and service catalog. Using this token now, so service catalog and endpoint information, it will reach out to the service it wants to communicate to. So that in this case, it's a NOAA service. And it's a success. So this is something that happens for all the services not specific to NOAA, whichever service you access. In case of Horizon, the token is actually cached and the token is reused for every API queries you make. The API query is also like Horizon uses Django, and you have options to make some changes on that also. Okay, so OpenStack Keystone architecture. So this is a very generic picture which people normally put in, showing multiple backends for Keystone. So the Keystone service has a lot of configurations. Based on those configurations, you can have multiple backend for those configurations. So policy backend, token backend, catalog backend, identity backend, assignment backend, and credential backend. So I will not discuss all the backends, but I will try directly show you the configuration file, and I will tell you which of those are of interest, and we will discuss now. But all of those configuration can be used, but the configurations are so vast that it's not easy for us to discuss it in a session. So these are all of the configurations that are there in OpenStack Keystone, but I have just highlighted few, and I'm going to discuss just those. So Keystone configuration file has many sections with a box title starting default or something. Each has some set of behavior. Default is a generic overall worldwide configuration for Keystone. So if you want a specific configuration to be applied for all, if it is an option which is available for all Keystone, then it can mention under default. So I have I have shared this in SlideShare. So if you want, you can access this from SlideShare. It's there in the meetup page. I have linked the slides in the meetup page. It's the link is still there. So in the slides also, you can just click. So these are the configurations, which you, the upstream sample configuration, which will show you what are the defaults for each. So assignment actually refers to the roles, but we don't have much options. So most of these options don't have multiple, most of this configuration does not have multiple options as a backend. Most of these options use SQL. SQL stands for the data local database. So whenever you see somewhere written as equal to SQL, that means this is using. Okay. Yes. Thank you for mentioning that. Sorry, I'm just going to share my screen again, my entire screen again.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So I was actually referring to the configuration in keystone.conf, and I just opened the sample configuration from the upstream. So what I was saying is, wherever you see driver equal to SQL, it means it is going to use database, local database. So your local database also can be anywhere. So you can look at the section database to understand which database you're using. So there's a section called connection equal to, which will show which database connection you're going to use. The IP address and port can be mentioned over here. Next is the catalog service. So your catalog service also can be actually modified, but mostly you use the catalog service to always point to your database itself. So you will find here also SQL. So one of the main sections over here is identity. So identity tells which driver, backend driver, you're using for identity. Identity is actually authentication. So your authentication authorization, also authentication, whichever credentials you get should be authenticated with which driver. So you can have LDAP or any other drivers which Keystone supports. So it's the driver SQL. You can also have LDAP over here for LDAP based authentication. You also have a configuration to mention the memcache server. So memcache is the two application used for quick access to any objects you want from the memory itself. So if you have multiple Keystone services running, you will have to point it to the same memcache server. So there is another one option called cache also, but we use memcache compared to that. Usually memcache is used. You also have an option for token. So token, you have multiple types of token based on the format. So you have an option to mention what kind of token you have. So you have UUID token. Now we have only two types of token which we recommend. One is UUID, other is Fortinet tokens. So by default, your system uses Fortinet tokens for authentication. So the tokens also, they have some kind of behavior, like whether the token has to come back or not. So there are some advantage of taking one token over the other. So there is a PKI, PKZ, but I don't find that referred in the upstream doc. I think so. They may have deprecated it. but I could not find PKZ in the upstream docs. So let us come to the first demo. So first demo is we'll have an DevStack environment ready, and we will create some users, and we will test authentication authorization from our environment. Yeah. I'll just log in as stack user. I can source openrc admin. So as an admin user, let me try out some things. Oh, sorry, dev stack. So this openrc contains credentials for my environment, so it will be a good show for us to see now what's there. It's a little big file, but I'll try to concentrate on things that are important for us. So let me do one thing. Let me step out every line that starts with export. Okay. So you will notice that this is like project name, tenant name, username, password, region name, INT, API version 3, authentication type is password, auth URL, that is a Keystone URL. So all these values that you set over here, when you give an API command, these values are used when you send an API command. Like, for example, OpenStack token issue. So this is one of the very common commands that people use to understand if authentication works or not. So if authentication works, then you will get a token. So what if other commands? So other commands also you can use, but the thing is your other commands also probably can fail if in case you don't have permissions to access environment. So I will just do an OpenStack token issue. So I get a token ID, okay, for my user ID. So this is, I know that this got authenticated with Keystone. I got a token back from my Keystone server. I could probably show you what's going on by putting OpenStack --debug. And you will notice that how this sends a query to the Keystone server and with token at the end, and gets a result with the token somewhere in the reply. Even if I do something like this, I call a different API server list, you will notice that this actually still reaches to Keystone. So you would notice that Keystone, this is the URL to Keystone. Okay, I'll keep this in mind, --identity version 3. Oh, sorry. Let me just redirect this to a file. You will notice first it will find out the auth URL from your shell environments. This value is set, and it will use this let me do one thing. Let me just search out this value, which will be easy for me to find out where all URL is used. Somewhere it gets. So I'm finding for a point where it says it look for service. It goes a service catalog. So this is the NOAA API reached. So it goes got a token from your INT service. So this is what I was showing, that even though I did a NOAA service test, it first went in to KeyStone and got the token. Okay, so create a user. I have some set of commands already with me. So before I go to that, let me just show you all the things that we discussed, the service list, catalog. So each of the service will have some endpoints, which will be shown in catalog list. So when you give an API, you actually tell to KeyStone, I want the endpoint for this service. Endpoint list will give a much like bigger output because it will show you all and everything. So for each, it is given a different line, public URL for glance and it's showing only a public something wrong, but it normally shows all the endpoints, public, admin and internal. User list right now will only show your system user. So every service also has a username. So when I told you, right, this user want, if NOAA wanted to communicate to Cinder, that means what? The NOAA service should have a username, right, to authenticate and get something if it has to communicate for any reason.
It means like it will back and forth authenticate with KeyStone?
Yes.
For every
request? I'm not sure for every request because for services, I probably it can cache. I'm not very sure of that. So one more thing is, if a user is doing something, the user's token will go, not the service. If at all you think, right, you know, if I'm doing a NOAA list or service list, OpenStack server list, it is actually the user's token that comes into picture. That makes sense also, right? If you are spawning an instance and attaching a volume, what if that user does not have permission on that volume? It does not have that policy. There's a policy to block that user from using. So if NOAA were to send a, you know, token from itself, right? So that won't make sense. You need to give the token of the user to Cinder to make sure that this user has that permission or not. If not, the Cinder API will fail with permission, like forwarding or something.
NOAA goes to glance. It is his credentials.
Okay.
To get the Glenn's endpoint. When Nova needs Glenn's, then it will go to KeyStone and say, well, where is the KeyStone? Oh. And that time it will use his credentials.
I am getting yes, sorry.
Means you had a request to create an instance. So at that time Nova needs to connect to Glenn's. So at that time it will use his credentials to connect to KeyStone and say where is the Glenn's.
Yeah.
And at that time Nova credentials will be used.
Yeah. Okay. So to get a service endpoint. Yeah. Let's see. Okay, so I don't have a user. Let me create two users. So these users will be created in my default. So I'll just give a simple default IT backend. That is SQL. SQL means my database. If I could probably just look at how do I check the configuration dev check this etc.
Yeah,
same place. So I'm just going to look at the identity section. Identity section is driver SQL. So SQL means it's the database. And if I have to search the database, so there's a database section and the password. So I can probably do a MySQL and search also right now. So it should work perfectly fine. So yes. It use the same credentials for saving. So use KeyStone. Since I've just come over here, let me just show you the tables it has. Okay, so this is your KeyStone database. So what did I do till now? I just created a user Alice. So let me create one more user John. So I could just do a user show to show you what all information it has. Nothing much for a user. User ID and email address. Domain is default, by the way. So by default, it uses default domain. Or else you'll have to mention a domain name for while creating user. So I can create a project, and I will mention domain. Notice this command will fail. This will not fail. But usually in your environment, if you have V2 version, it would fail. But we had looked at that open RC file earlier, right? And we noticed that V3 was enabled. So INT API version V3.
If it is V2, this will fail.
Yeah, this would fail. Because V2 does not have the concept of domain. Okay, that's fine. So anyway, when you have a production environment, probably you will have a port number for Keystone, like colon 5000, something like that. And you will notice that auth URL over here mentioned will be something like, something like this, with the IP address, port number, and slash v3. And the NTIP API version. So I have not created a role yet. I created a project. I can create a role. Probably I'll create two roles for each of this user. And let me try to play around with giving policies to each of these users, or based on the role, I can give each of this some ability and see how it works. So I created two. Two roles, compute user and shady user. So the shady user role is supposed to have shady character. So that's why I gave it the name shady. I will add this user Alice into compute user, and I will add this user John in shady user role. So right now I have not put any policy. So whatever policies are there, that is default Keystone policies. So if I use this user shady, let me use this OpenRC, does it give option to give password also?
Voice password.
Okay. Password for Alice is A. Okay, and I will also source this credentials files. I will say, yes, oh, I'm so sorry. So let me clear my screen. So what I just do is I just set export OS password as A, because I'm going to use user Alice. So rest of the user credentials, let me just set using OpenRC script Alice and project admin. I hope first is okay, yeah. So now OpenStack, my first command to see if I'm able to project is Acme, which yeah right. So let me issue a token. Am I getting a token? OS password.
We can copy this file and we can create a new.
Yeah, right.
Open RC file and make a change there.
Yeah. Open RC Alice and Open RC. And project name username is Alice and secret is me issue a token. I get it to password.
We can directly, can we pass password directly from CA?
Yes. Post password. So somehow it's not taking password. Okay, that's fine.
Yeah.
So you got a token. So you know that it is it's able to authenticate. Maybe I can run some other commands and see if the API allows me to run some other commands like service list. Is this actually OpenStack service list? See, I get another error. You are not authorized to perform the requested action.
Maybe something wrong in OpenRC-Alice.
Policy.json.
Yes. So the thing is, this is actually an example which I planned.
Yeah.
That the normal user is not admin of the project.
Yeah.
He's a normal user. He's not able to get the service list of all services. What about catalog? So you're getting catalog, but it's not getting service.
Yeah.
So the same thing is valid for the other guy John also. John's password is J. P. Oh, sorry, I did not modify anything, John. This guy also is the same thing. He will probably be able to. Sorry. So this guy will be able to list the catalog like the evils. It's me. Okay, I will reduce my pain by just putting everything inside. password OS auth dual was the URL. Oh, I can take the URL from here itself, catalog output. So, and username. Username is OS username. Oh, yes, sorry, it's OS username. I'm right. I'm wrong. Sorry. This user also can list the catalog. So let's look at why users cannot list service. So what is so odd about the service part? So there's something wrong with the policy. So we agree that there was something wrong with the policy. So this is the policy file. There's no policy file in DevStack.
In your setup, it's there.
Might be we can check in the class properties tabs.
Oh, yeah, right. So you're right. Let me just check if all the policies for the service are also there. Something wrong with my environment or let me just so I have another one environment which I can use. So this is my OpenStack directive based setup. There is Triplo based setup. Okay, so I have the same example over here. So this is a different system, and I was running actually on a different system. But for some reason, DevStack did not create the policy file in my DevStack environment. So I'll take a different environment. I already have workload RC file. I can say OpenStack service list. Same error, and if I do for source workload RC for Alice also, same error. The same scenario I'm explaining, but in this case, in my environment, there is a policy file. So let me do one thing. Let me look at the policy file. So this is my controller IP address. So I will log into my controller. Sudo as root. Let me just clear the screen. So this is my controller. There's a KeyStone service running over here. And so I have a KeyStone service running over here. Let me look at the KeyStone policy. So something around the API request to service list. Okay, so this is my policy file. So you will mainly find two types of entry. One is to define a rule. Okay, rule means a rule to say which all users are applicable will get applied to this rule. For example, the first line is admin underscore required. That is a rule name. Okay, and then I say what all filters or what all combination applies to fall under, should be applied to fall under this rule. So admin required means either your role on that project is admin or you are actually the admin user. So that is what this line means, admin required. Okay, service role, role is service, like that. You have couple of rules over here. And then you have the service API, which will look at the rule you have set for it. For example, if you want to delete your region using a Keystone API, Keystone API will check when there's a request, Keystone API will check this policy and find out who all are allowed to do it. So in this case, rule is admin required. So immediately, it will try to check if there is a rule by the name admin required. Here it is. So it will apply this rule. If this results in positive, then it will allow that user to run that API successfully. That is delete region. In my case, it is listing services. I did OpenStack services. It did not work. So this is the rule it tried to apply. What does it say? Rule admin required. So when you say admin required, that is this the rule. So either the user has to be admin or either the role has to be admin or the user itself is the admin user. Okay, so okay, that is that makes it clear. That is why, because the user is not admin, it is actually in the role called compute user. So what I can do is on this line, okay, I can mention something similar to this example. You see that? So I have a role admin. There's already rule over here. I can write or role is compute user. Okay. So this will make sure that when Alice runs this request, Keystone will understand that this user has access to run this command. Source.
Restart the
no, we don't need to restart this. It will automatically consider that from the policy file. So service list now works for Alice. But if I do source overcloud RC for John, that will still not work because John is not in that role. So if I wanted John to also do, either I can add to that rule saying that role shady user also, or else I can add John into compute user role also. So I can do both. So I can try that out. I can just say John is also part of compute user. Oh, we source workflow. So I need to do something from admin. So I will just source the admin password and add John to a compute user role. And now I will again source overcloud RC for John, use John's credentials, and I run the same command again. Service list. Now it works. So that is how we tested the policy and that's authorization using Keystone. So should we wait for anyone to test this? Do you want to practice this?
Since we are recording, we will pass the recording.
Yeah.
and we don't have file store JSON available.
You can download or save.
What you don't have?
The file store JSON to add the policy just in case. We don't have it with data.
It's not there? But it was there for you, right?
Yes, I think I have done first Okata and then master. So I think because of Okata, I have.
Oh, okay. Okay. So I also did master.
Like KeyStone. I think we need to enable something in the local RC file. After that,
no, I think in master they have removed this.
Maybe.
So we can share. I can share it.
Yeah, later on. Yeah. Okay. Let's go.
Okay, so next section, next part I want to discuss is integration with IPA. So I was supposed to have a demo for this also, but I'm not very sure because I'm facing some issue with the Docker container, and let's see. Okay, so LDAP integration for identity. So basically, you want to make sure that your Keystone can authenticate with something like Active Directory or your IPA or any LDAP server also. So you can have one backend, LDAP backend or Active Directory or LDAP based backend for each domain. So you can create a domain, and for that domain, you can provide a backend for it. So how do you do that? You need to first enable some SLinux. If in case you are putting SLinux, so by the way, SLinux is a security policy on your Linux systems, and it can apply to ports, it can apply to process. So there's a logic of subject and object to it, and so you have to make sure if your process is or user is trying to access any file or port, it needs to enable some SLinux policies for it to work. Is something like a security. So I'll have to, if you're using SLinux, you have to enable this boolean. So you need to configure Keystone to an extra line, sorry. So you need to modify keystone.conf to tell there are multiple domains, and you have to tell which directory it needs to check for the domain related information. So for that, I will come to this identity section. So we had reviewed this identity section earlier inside the configuration file, identity. So in this identity section in the keystone.conf, I have to mention that there are multiple backends for your identity, and you have to mention the directory in which it can search for the configuration file for each backend identity. Okay. After you do that, you have to create a file for the domain itself, the identity backend you are going to create. I've already mentioned that etc keystone domains is going to be used as the directory source for all the configuration for identity backends. So inside that, I have to create keystone etc keystone domains. I have to name something by name keystone dot the domain name for which you're going to use that configuration dot conf. So inside this configuration file, there are two entries. One is LDAP and one is identity. So these two sections are there also in the main keystone.conf file, but this configuration is specific for this domain backend, which you are configuring now.
Domain means the Keystone domain
or? Yes, Keystone domain. Yes. So the domain is a Keystone domain. So the Keystone will use this Keystone dot that domain name dot conf for authenticating users for that domain. So the LDAP section may look familiar if you have used LDAP somewhere. First is you provide the URL of the LDAP server, that is actually your IP address, hostname resolver, host IP to an IP address. If you're using SSL, then you'll have to make sure your DevStack environment has the SSL bundled with the CA certificate. Then you have user ID it will use to log in and run queries on the LDAP server. So you will have to create an LDAP user on your LDAP server or IPA server or Active Directory server, create a user, which the Keystone can use to query inside the directory service. This user does not need to be admin. So the password does not need to be available for this user. If it is hashed, I mean, blocked out results is fine. User filter is one of the main part of this configuration. It tells which filter to use in this LDAP server to find the users. Okay, so this is like a, what you call the base, this is like a distinguished name, that is DN. So member of CN equal to group, this CN equal to groups, this is the path to the group. So whenever I create the user inside in my LDAP, say for example IPA, I will add that user inside the group also, and this is the location path of that group. The password of this user which is going to query, that is the user UUID which I mentioned, SVC-LDAP, that's username, that user's name's password. So user tree distinguished name is where all the users actual objects are, distinguished names are under this path of LDAP. Okay, now users can be saved in different objects. So you can have, you know, LDAP, you have multiple schemas to define different information in one object. So inet.org is one of the most common names used for defining users. You can also use inet with Linux authentication. So you can use SSSD to authenticate with LDAP, and those kind of mapping also use inet based objects. So inet is very common. Inet user. So inet. User ID is the attribute of user ID attribute which has a actual user ID in the schema. So similarly, these all like user ID attribute, user name attribute, mail attribute, pass attribute. These all are options which gives you an ability to map to actual schema values which has the required data. So it depends what schema you're using. If you're using a different schema, not like a init user, then maybe your user ID may be in a different name inside the schema. Allow user create, allow update, allow delete from the Keystone. So I've never tested this. Then you can mention the TLS certificate for connecting to the LDAP server. Irrespective of this, you will still have to add the CA certificate in your bundle in the Linux system. There is users and groups I mentioned, which you can save in Keystone. So you can also have group tree where Keystone can search for the groups of that domain in this specific path in LDAP server. And the object over there. And this all is using the which driver? LDAP driver. That is inside the identity section. So easy way to test this is for us to create an IPA container. So this is the command I usually use to create IPA container. So I usually test it on the host system, and I create a VM on my host system to deploy DevStack or any director based OpenStack installation, and I try to use the 172.17.0.1 IP address to access my IPA server. So I was facing some issues in spawning the IPA server. So since this is a different environment, I don't have the IPA server created over here. Let me run this now. So who all were able to get the IPA image and spawn a container?
Downloading them.
Okay.
But the command was not working.
Yes. So this command usually works fine for me, but I face some issue on the latest version on RHEL 7.3 or CentOS 7. Maybe something what changed, but it worked perfectly fine earlier. So let me just tell you what this command does. So Docker is used for spawning container. So mostly these INT service applications are very complex. But this IPA has an automatic installation procedure. So I thought of using IPA container to deploy an INT policy management server. So I just used Docker run privilege net bridge. It will use a default bridge in Docker. You have an option to share the mount point from the container. So I just want to share the varlib IPA data, because varlib IPA data can contain a configuration file which can be automatically used for the IPA server. But although I am not going to use it right now, I have not used it, but I usually use this command. -v slash varlog of the container is in slash data IPA1 IPA log. So I have to make sure that this directory and this directory is already present on the Docker host. Your application also requires some C group related this. Being a container, it's not like a VM, so you will not have all the functionalities of a running kernel. So you will have to share some information from your host, like C group information. So I will share the host C group directory with the container. What's this? Okay.
Mm-hmm. The C group directory will be held. What information will be held?
So this C group is actually used to in Linux system to limit the resources like network or
that will be pushing to the image.
Yeah. So the reason why we are doing is this application depends on C groups. So if I go to install it, it will fail because I don't have any C group inside the container. So if you have any other application which requires C groups, probably you'll have to do the same thing for that application also. -h, the host name for the container. So this is an INT management solution. So this is important. It's important to give a host name, a temporary slash run and slash TMP directory, IPA server IP 192.17.0.1. To make the ports available from the container to the host, I need to make sure I add -p, the IP address : the port from the container to, and it's mapped to port on the host.
This IP address is what exactly, the container?
Yes, the container.
So we are sending a manual IP address over there?
So I know my first container will get 172.17.0.1 IP. Yeah, one and two both will be pointing to this. This container only. So I can use here 172.17.0.1 also, two also.
I think it would be better if we use host bridge networking than 0.1 is a Docker bridge IP.
Exactly.
Instead of bridge, we can use host, and Docker bridge IP is 0.1, so it should work.
So well, I did not try it, but this works fine for me. So I did not go to try the next IP address. I understood what you said, because the .1 is the bridge on the host.
Because I checked when I log into the container, there is one file, I think IPA server IP. There it is returns 172.0 what we gave on the command line.
Okay.
It should be the container's IP.
No, but the -p does not go inside the configuration. -p is for the Docker. It does not go to the application. Wait. Where did I mention IP over here?
IP is server IP. The second or third line. IP is server IP.
The first word.
So this can be two also, right? Anyway, this has known to work. Anyway, that's. I've not tested with two, but one works perfectly fine. But just a small change I'm making from this command is I'm removing port 80 and port 443, because any port 80 port 443 is not used. And in this case, we have our Horizon and other HTTP applications running on port 443 and port 80. I will not wait for the container to get installed, because that will take long time. So immediately after I run this command, I will try to modify the configuration files just to give you an idea of how we usually create the configuration files and stuff.
Can you remove that 18?
Yes. Once I'll.
IP should be exist on the host. Port name.
I didn't get what you said actually.
Means -p, you have written a 172.17.0.2.
Yeah.
This IP should exist on your host. Is it there?
Yeah, so it should be there, huh?
.0.1 will be there, not 0.2.
Yeah.
But you have written 0.2 in the command.
For each IP. So you are referring to only one entry, not for all.
All entry.
That's what I put now to. You want me to change it to one?
No, I wanted only the IP server IP.
IP server IP should be 0.2.
Yeah.
Or else it should be 0.1. Change it in the first one itself.
First one only one entry.
The first is done.
That this we have to.
So I will let it run. So this command usually takes around 20 minutes or more, depending upon how fast your host is. This will take some time for it to complete. In the meantime, let me just show you what is the required configuration. So I'll just log into my controller. Keystone.conf. First thing, I will check for the identity section. So domain specific drivers enabled is should be true. And your domains configuration directory is etc keystone domains. I need to create a domain. I had actually created a domain earlier by the name. What was the name?
No, sorry, I
did not create. I thought I created. That's okay. So let me create a domain. Gave it a name India-1, so I'm going to use the same domain name over there when I create a file. Keystone domains. By default, this directory is not created. I need to create this directory. I have to make sure Keystone owns it. Keystone dot, the domain name is India-1. Yes, sorry, I'm sorry again. So I'll just create Keystone dot, the domain name which I've created dot conf. I already have the text with me, so I'll just copy paste my text content. And then modify what I need to modify. LDAP is APA India-1. So this is the hostname I gave for the container also. So this user is not yet there. So once the LDAP server is created, I have to make this user and give a password over here. Whatever is the password we can put here over here. Although for this user, for this IPA deployment, this will be the path for whatever. So I need to create group-openstack also over here, but the rest of the path will be same for this IPA kind of deployments. This is the path for groups and users. I also would need to copy the CA certificate over here. So this is how you will have LDAP authentication. I can So you said there was snacks or something. Should we have that now? Because okay. So we can. So after that, we have hyperscalers, right? So we can take a break now.
Yeah.
Because this output, I will probably have to look at what's
the issue. Yeah, so stop the session.
Okay.
You can conclude the session, end the session.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
you'll be sharing this
except this ADAP part.
Yes. So, so you already saw the overcloud RC file, right? So the only difference is in my overcloud RC file, so not overcloud RC, open RC file, I would just have to make sure the username, which is already there inside the IPA. So how do I create user IP? Is just there's a command called IPA user create, whatever INT backend you have, create a user over there, and it will be visible on your OpenStack environment. So OpenStack user list will show you users from your backend. But you will have to mention the domain. For example, if I have to list user, I'll have to say OpenStack user list double hyphen domain. Here I have mentioned default, but in my environment, once I deploy it, I source it. So I would probably put the domain, whichever you have India one, whichever domain you have created and you have backend configured, you'll mention over here and can hit an enter, and Keystone will check the backend driver for that domain and find out the credentials, which will have the credentials, and use that domain path inside, and it will query inside the LDAP server and it will authenticate. It's almost.
Yeah, so I'm stopping the recording.
Now the command is working on my. Big is working.
Big is working, right? So it means that there's an IP container running. So probably you can test it.
I have basically the new command already there.
Okay.
So you might update the this type.
Yeah.
Document is updated.
Yeah.
With what other this?
The new command is updated on the Etherpad, which is working.
Is it running?
It is running. Okay. It is creating the whole IPA right now.